Okay, I have two hats, so I need to make a short presentation, and then we'll have some discussions over the issues we just made a presentation among ourselves, and then we'll have a break, and then we'll open the floor. Okay, what I'm trying to present is basically a little bit about the role of the G20 in current situations. So the main point I would like to make is basically the G20 is important because for the global cooperation, now is all the nations are quite interlinked through the various markets, including the financial and trade. So we need to address the global problems through the global corporations. So even though G20 might not be the most effective, still it's far from the fully functioning. But I think the G20 is at this moment the most important international forum which can address the global problems. And then I'll just speak to a little bit the issues linking the regional or national level crisis response mechanisms to the G20s or global mechanisms. So I think as I spoke during the lunch, basically even the Eurozone crisis now becomes a global crisis. It has strong global spillovers mainly through the trade and financial markets. So now emerging countries now is getting into the much more negative impact from the deteriorating situation in the Eurozones. Okay, what should G20 did in these situations? I think G20 has mobilized its own effort to address the global problems. Well, I think I know that there are some strong skepticism, but we cannot deny that G20 was very effective as a new global governance system, especially the coordinating policies during the second worst global financial crisis since World War II. So we have several summits over the past 4 years. Okay, so of course, the important thing is the G20 is to reflect the new global landscape, which mainly addressing the rising economic class and influences of important emerging countries. Now it accounts for more than 2/3 of the global populations and over 85% of the GDP. So it's in the world. So it's either increased its share in the total population as well as the total GDP in the world. So it becomes more and more important. So what G20 is trying to do? There are a lot of discussions what G20 should do, but G20's main objective is basically to promote the strong, sustainable, and balanced growth of the world economy. So there are a lot of things G20 could do, but the main discussion is how make it more effective in addressing the economic problems. So it may not really extending its work into the other global issues, but I think I know that there are skepticism that it may not address most effectively Eurozone debt crisis. Well, the main question is this is from the Financial Times. Why not G7 or G8? And then we can promote this effective global leadership among the G20 countries. Even within the G20, obviously, G7 and G8, not mostly G7, has promoted their own interest through a lot of meetings over the past decades. So they could call each other and they can make very quick decisions. But other countries, especially emerging countries, may not have that cooperation mechanism. Also, this is a new governance system. So it's very difficult to promote a common interest among the G20 countries, especially between the advanced countries and emerging countries. But I think the role of the emerging countries is very important because now the economic influences of the emerging countries become very, very important. So even though, the reality is still make it very difficult to promote the common interest among the G20 countries or making the G20 work most effectively, we need to make it happen to become the most effective global governance systems. But I don't want to address what the G20 did over the past, the previous meetings. But for example, in Seoul, At least I mean, the people may not deny that it made a very successful reform of the IMF quota and the governance systems. And then we brought very important two agendas, such as the development consensus and global financial safety net. So it makes more effective, more estimate by addressing the problems which are more pertinent to the developing and emerging countries. And we also expanded a lot of outreach activities. I think Colin made a very good point. I think it's how the communication makes more effective is very important. So people's awareness of the role of the G20 is important. So we promoted outreach activities. I'll get to this issue later. In Ghana summit, of course, I mean, it could not solve the Eurozone crisis entirely. But if you read the statement, and I was there, and then at least, I mean, at that time, there was a significant disturbance from the Greece because this Greek prime minister just called for the referendum. So I don't know why he did, but anyway. So it made everyone is complicated. So one day before the meeting, European leaders met separately, and then Sarkozy called this Greek prime minister at the time to come to the GAN. And then they have meetings, and they persuaded them to the scrap his this referendum call. But at least, I mean, and then it was successful. So we prevented at least for the acceleration of the Eurozone crisis at this moment. I mean, there was a lot of the pessimistic views it could be accelerated. But in the communique, it was very clear what should be the plan the Eurozone leaders should do, I mean, to make the Euro much safer. Okay, now it's going to the Mexico. Okay, whether Mexico will make it successful. Well, frankly, I'm a little bit worried. I went to the Mexican City, and it was last week. And we had a Sherpa meeting. So basically, the one issue is the meeting will be in June because they'll have the presidential election in July. I mean, there is no reason why they decided to have the summit in June, except their presidential election is in July. So, of course, I mean, the priority is to basically provide the solutions to the current global problems. But we will see, I mean, how much it will work effectively. We are trying to help the Mexican government to make its summit most successful. As you may know, I mean, one important issue is how to expand the IMF resources to basically, as Colin said, is the providing the a larger firewall. I mean, this is now is the big debate is going on. And then what would be the capacity of the Eurozone countries to address its own problems? Basically, the non-European countries would like to wait to see, I mean, how the European countries mobilize their resources as much as they could. And then add their own resources to that. I mean, so there are some parallel discussions are going on at this moment in EU and in G20, as well as at the IMF. Well, in the future, of course, I mean, there are big questions whether G20 could be a most effective global governance. I think it's what Colin said. I mean, basically the national interest versus global interest. Basically, the global coordination sometimes requires losing pursuing their own national interest. Of course, I mean, this is the fundamental problems in everywhere when you got into the global forum. But having said that, I mean, from my experience, at least the G20 countries are serious to manage the current crisis and also to build up the global economic paradigm, which may be more effective in preventing the next crisis. So we'll see. I mean, I think as I said, basically G20 mobilized not just the advanced countries, but also emerging countries. I think there are a lot of challenges to communicate with each other. It's not just translating their own languages, but I think it's sometimes communicating between leaders, among the leaders, communicating through the interpreters. Sometimes they lose the their intimacy, but I think it's the, we'll work on that. Okay, so, but I think it's the, another important issue is I would like to address is the last one. The one of the G20 role is the, of course, I mean, G20 can become the very effective global governance, but another one is the, it can improve existing global institutions. I think this is very important. The role of the G20, which reflects the increasing power of emerging countries, is the legitimate to address these problems in the existing global institutions. We need to reflect the adequate influence of the emerging countries. So that's why G20 addressed the reforming the IMF quota and governance. Think about these ownership issues. I think why people are discussing this Asia's own institutions, because they feel more ownership. That means they feel more responsibility. So I think that this is the, another issue. So we try to build up the FSB. I think it's the one important issue is the how to strengthen the WTO negotiations, because trade is very important. This is a huge challenge. And also addressing the other issues such as environment would be also very important. I'll skip the Korea's role here. Well, but Korea, of course, we hosted the G20 summit, but it's the G20 process is not really only done by the chair, but it's the, basically the coordinated effort by the G20 countries. Let me just address the one more issues very briefly on this. We have a lot of discussions about global institutions such as G20, even though maybe you may not call G20 as an institution, it's still informal grouping, informal meeting at this moment. But I think there are also a lot of discussions of the role of the regional institutions. What Kawai and Chanapap said is that I completely agree. There is the role of the regional institutions. I just wrote down some regions, why the regional institutions should play the role complementing the global institutions. Well, we need to integrations at both regional and global levels. Of course, I mean, global, for example, global free trade is the first best. But negotiation cost is huge, and then there you need to reflect all the various interests from the all around the countries all around the world. It takes a lot of time. So that means we should not give up. At the regional level, neighbors, the benefit from the more further integrations, especially in trade, is much larger. So you need to promote the regional integrations. And also the comparability of regional and global norms are very important. Otherwise, at the end, we may get into the problems, the complicated issues related to the not harmonizing rules. Okay, and then global challenges, but we when we address global challenges, we should not lose the insight that there are some differing regional characteristics or own the national characteristics. They are also very important to address the national interest. Okay, and so this one is the, just mentioned by the, some people, especially Chanapap and Mr. Kawai. I think it's a financial safety. We discussed the financial crisis. Let's get into this issue. How to prevent, how to manage the financial crisis? For example, how to prevent the crisis from the Thailand perspective? What Chanapap said is completely true and important. National level, the sound economic policy is very important. As Mr. Kawai said, well, there is, must be prudential regulations, strong macroeconomic policies, well-designed capital controls. As Chanapap said, reserve could play a very important role. Yes, you need to reserve, international reserves, because the capital can fly out very quickly in current this financial globalization situation. So we need to promote the reserves. But accumulating reserves is very costly, and it's not the best solutions. We need to supplement mechanisms at the regional level as well as international level. So IMF can provide some additional resources, and the regional level, we can also complement the, all kinds of things together. So there are, of course, I mean, there are pros and cons in at the each level. So we need to complement all kinds of things together. For example, I mean, self-insurance is costly. Bilateral swaps maybe have a great impact, but it's the sometimes it's just determined by the political decisions. Regional pool, and but its resources are much smaller. IMF, there are stigma effect. So I think it's the, these are the all we need to consider. Mr. Skeptis, and okay, let me just stop my presentation.